Well, good morning, church. I hope you received that update well from Paul and Cole. So great to hear from them and to make them a part of our Sunday gathering. And as I mentioned just a moment ago, we are giving more through missions this year. We have set missions goals. We're going to be sharing those in the coming days and weeks with our Northern Life Church family for the missionaries that we give to on a regular basis, as well as ERDO and emergency relief. And we're looking forward to what God is going to do through Northern Life Church this year, through missions, through our giving. And we're grateful to do that. We also have new tithing envelopes, offering envelopes. So exciting. Anyways, if you're joining us online, you probably give online, so it doesn't really change anything. But if you use tithing envelopes, you need them. We'll be getting some your direction and new envelopes with some details on giving. And actually, I'll throw them up on the screen right now. You can take a quick little look. They'll just flash the front and back. And these are just our new tithes and offerings envelopes. I don't even know why I'm putting them on, but just having a little fun. Anyways, let's get into today's message. So grateful that we could share communion today. So grateful we could hear from Paul and Lynn Coles. Just wanted to give a shout out, especially to our online church family today. We had some of the best attendance we've had in a long time. Last Sunday, we had well over 100 people joining us online and in person. So all of our campuses last Sunday, it was, I wasn't expecting it, but was so excited to see that, you know, there's a hunger for God. That's what someone described to me this past week. There's a hunger for God right now. And no matter where you find yourselves, whether you're joining us online from home, whether you're at our little current campus, and of course, those that are gathering where I'm standing right now in our Espanola campus, there's a hunger for God across our region, and we're excited to be a part of that. So I encourage you to invite people to church. You may have even seen our our ads on Instagram, maybe on Facebook too, but mainly on Instagram for Northern Life Church, and to join us online each week. Maybe you saw our ad on Instagram this week and you're just checking us out. Man, I'm so excited, so honored that you've chosen to be with us today right here at northernlifechurch.online. Welcome to the Northern Life Church family. Today's message is a special one. Today is Vision Sunday for Northern Life Church. And we have Vision Sundays from time to time. I realize we haven't had an actual Vision Sunday in quite a long time, and that's my fault. And so I'm correcting that today. But today's Vision Sunday, and we're actually gonna, this is kind of part one today. We'll do another session next week. But today we're gonna talk about our vision and mission, specifically our vision today. And today is gonna be our first Vision Sunday of 2022. And we're excited for our theme this year, Back to Life. So many of you heard that message last week, and so exciting. And no matter what is going on and what triumphs or struggles we are experiencing, I believe for us as a church, we should often look to our vision and mission. We should look to what God has called us to, what he is calling us into in our lives. Most of the time, when I don't know about you, but most of the time when I hear organizations talk like this, I tend to think it's just empty statements. Like people say things and they don't really know what they're talking about. Even your bank has a vision and mission statement. If you look it up, everyone kind of banks at a major bank for the most part. Your bank has a vision and mission statement. Maybe your doctor's office has a vision and mission statement. It can happen, absolutely. Maybe even your gym, or hey, how about this? Maybe even your curling club has a vision and mission. I wouldn't know what that would be personally, but maybe that's true. Even Coach Ted Lasso on that TV show that's not actually on TV has one for his soccer/football team, his vision and mission statement. He smacks it on the wall, believe. Which I actually think he stole from the church. But anyways, that's a story for another day. So our challenge is to make what we believe the Lord Jesus has given and spoken to us and execute that vision and mission so that it isn't just words or something we reference, or it isn't just hung somewhere on a wall. For so many churches, I actually haven't put our vision statement technically on the wall. I'm going to do that this year. I'm going to find somewhere to display our vision statement that we're going to talk about today. But I know some churches, they have it plastered on their wall, and you just kind of forget that it's there over time. So let's take a look at our vision today. And that's kind of what we're going to focus on. I'll share some stuff about our mission statement and our core values at the very end quickly, and we'll talk more about that next week. But here's our vision. When you hear the word vision at our church, I want you to think of this. So I've met so many people over the years to say, what's your vision, right? It could be for anything, and I find it quite confusing. But when you ask that question, when you hear the word vision at our church, I want you to think of this. Here's our vision statement. It'll be up on the screen. Leading people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. Why don't you say it along with me wherever you're joining me from today. Leading people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. That's the vision statement for Northern Life Church. We are leading people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. Well, here's a question that some of you may be asking, and I've kind of thought about this. Well, how do we define that a relationship is growing with Christ? How do I define that a relationship is growing with Jesus Christ? Well, here's a thought that I want you to remember today. It's a super key thought. And I just want you to just kind of stick it in your memory, take a mental note of it. Here's what it is. What's the definition of a relationship that is growing with Jesus Christ? Here it is. A growing relationship with Jesus bears fruit. A growing relationship with Jesus bears fruit. Can you say that with me? I'm gonna say it one more time. A growing relationship with Jesus bears fruit. Well, Pastor, where do you find that? Where do you hear about that? Well, we find this statement. I'm taking this from Scripture. And actually, we're gonna read from John chapter 15, verses 12 to 17 today. The words are gonna be on the screen. So join with me today, especially from home, join with me and read along with me. It says this in John 15, verse 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide. So that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you so that you will love one another. Let's read verse 16 again. You should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide. That's where we get the thought I shared just a moment ago. A growing relationship with Jesus bears fruit. A growing relationship with Jesus bears fruit. Our first thought today is this: love one another like Christ loves us. Love one another like Christ loves us. As we grow in our relationship with Jesus, our love for one another increases. And not just for believers, but for all people. Our love for all people increases. This is an indicator of us growing in our relationship with God. If we actually are growing in the things of God, our ability to love grows along with it. Some may feel incapable of loving people more. Maybe you think, I've got enough love going on in my life. It's, you know, some people may feel a little incapable, but through the power of Holy Spirit, we can grow in love. Our capacity for love can increase through the power of the Spirit. Ephesians 5 verse 2 says this, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. So our first thought today, love one another like Christ has loved us. Our second thought is this: be willing to give your life for another. Be willing to give your life for another. You know, these days we love the thought, but it's a challenge to give our life for another. Sometimes people, when you're in love, you kind of promise ridiculous things to each other just to convince the other person of your love for them. Oh man, it's important for us. Are we willing to give our life for another? I need to be willing to give my life for another. Maybe this is in relation to a spouse where one gives up their goals and ambitions so that the other can excel in what they feel called to do. Sometimes spouses go in different directions when they're raising a family, but we need to go in the same direction together. So maybe it's one person, one spouse sacrificing so that another can excel in what they feel that they are called to do. Maybe this is someone who gives up a season in their life to serve a friend or loved one who would otherwise be marginalized or forgotten. I find it so powerful when people will give up of their time and resources for a friend or a family member to care for them through a difficult season in their life. Again, let's look to the Lord. John 10 verse 11 says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Verse 15, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father and I lay down my life for the sheep. I love that. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Laying down my life for someone else means putting someone else's needs before my own. How many of us in these days put our needs secondary so that someone else's needs can go forward? Of course, I think the relationship we see that most often is with a mother or a father, with their child, putting their child's needs first. Well, here's a news flash. We live in an extremely selfish culture. If you're wondering, or if you disagree with me, let me know. But I think we live in an extremely selfish culture. We all fall prey to selfishness. There's always someone that says, well, not me. I'm not like that, Pastor. I'm not selfish at all. Yeah, okay, the truth is, every one of us falls prey to selfishness at some point or another. Even I fall prey to it. This week, you will have the opportunity to put your needs before someone else. I can promise you, if you put this into practice this week, if you say, God, I'm gonna put my life on hold so that I can put someone else first. I'm gonna lay down my life so I can put someone else first. I guarantee you that this week, there will be an opportunity to put your needs in front of someone else's needs. How we respond in these circumstances is an indicator to how we are growing with Christ. If I say, God, I promise you that I'm gonna put others' needs before me, if I am actually growing in Christ, I will put someone else's needs before mine. It may not be easy, but I will recognize it. I'll recognize my selfishness and I'll put someone else's needs before mine. Sometimes we can get this concept of laying our life down for another. It's a great thought. It's in the Bible. God calls us to it. But sometimes we can get this thought confused. Be mindful of who and what you are sacrificing for. Sometimes we choose to sacrifice things that God has not called us to sacrifice. Would the Lord ask us to sacrifice our family so that we can impress our boss at work more? Would God ask you or me to sacrifice the needs of our family so that we could impress our boss at work more? Unlikely. I'll say it nicely. Unlikely. Well, would the Lord ask us to support a friend or another family while forsaking our own family? Again, unlikely. Here's another one. Would the Lord ask us to sacrifice some of what we have, resisting the urge to upgrade something in our lives so that we could maybe give more financially to someone in need? Maybe we could give more to missions like we've heard from some missionaries today. Yes, I believe that God is likely to do something like that. God is likely to challenge us to sacrifice financially in an area of our life so that we can give to something like missions, as we've heard from today. Over the years when I was a youth pastor, don't laugh, it was actually not that long ago, depending on how old you are. Anyways, over the years when I was a youth pastor, I had people sacrifice financially to see that as many students as possible could make it to a youth retreat we were going on or make it to a missions trip that we were going on. You see, being able, I was in this interesting position where I knew the financial sacrifices that some were making to enable an experience for students in our church across that region. And I was able to see that sacrifice turn into a tangible spiritual growth in someone's life. It is a powerful blessing to see someone's sacrifice yield so much fruit, bear fruit in someone's life. Church, always be willing to give from your life so that another's life can grow. Always be willing to give from your life so that another life can grow. So good. All right, here's our third thought for today. Our fear of God must be greater than any other fear. So we're going to talk about fear. This has been on my heart this week. We're going to talk a little bit about fear. Let's get into it. Sometimes doing what we are commanded to do can be a form of fear. Sometimes we think a commandment, it can lead us to fear in some capacity. I don't know how many of you remember your first paid job, maybe when you were a kid or a teenager or something like that. I remember the first job I got, I was fearful. I was scared. I did not want to mess up that job. I felt like the whole world was hinging on that important job I had when I was 12 or 13 years old, whatever. In this job, I was so scared. I would not stop working until the boss I had told me to take a break. I didn't know anything about employment law, nothing like that. So I would work as long and as hard as possible. I was young, so it didn't hurt me too bad. But I would not stop working until the boss I had told me to take a break. And eventually they would. They weren't mean or anything like that. But I couldn't stop. I was fearful. I wanted to do so well in that position. Sometimes I see kids and teenagers in their first job, just like you've seen people in their first jobs over the years. And I find they are either working really hard. They're like me. They're like going all over trying to figure everything out and working really hard. Or they act like they don't want to be there, or I certainly have no idea what they're doing. But the truth is, they're both situations, there's fear in both situations. Doing what the Lord commands of us is different. Doing as the Lord commands of us is connected to fear from a certain point of view. One of my oldest memories is when, in my own life, I began to process what fearing God meant. My goodness, do we mess the fear of God up. When the Bible teaches us about fear, we learn a few things. First off, we learn that there is something called unhealthy fear. Unhealthy fear is what many of us deal with on a day-to-day basis. It's connected to God, in my opinion, because we translate our unhealthy fear and we put it on God's shoulders. The Greek word in the New Testament for this is phobos. We get the word phobia from this Greek word phobos. Phobia is an unhealthy fear. When you have a phobia of something, that is an unhealthy fear. The definition of a phobia could be when I overestimate the danger and underestimate my ability to cope. How many of us do that in so many areas of our life, including our faith? We overestimate the danger and underestimate our ability to cope. If I was teaching this specific thing about fear in something like a school setting, maybe a Bible school setting, I'd have a slide like this. I'm gonna put it up on the screen. I'd have a slide like this. It would go, fear, false evidence appearing real. Maybe you could take a screen grab or write that down. False evidence appearing real. That's what fear is, false evidence appearing real. Common phobias that would be in a gathering of people similar to this today is simply this: phobias related to health or finances, failure, growing old, death, loneliness, rejection, messing up, public speaking, flying, heights, snakes, and spiders. That's what phobias would be related to today. I laughed at the spider one because I'm not scared of spiders. Anyways, I'm going to stop us from going any further down this road. I'm just going to freak people out. But here's a quote from Nikki Gumbel about fear that I wanted to share with you today. Nikki said this: the Spirit of God does not produce negative fear. There is a kind of healthy fear, the fear of God. This does not mean being frightened of God. In fact, it means the opposite. It is an understanding of who God is in relation to us. It means respect, reverence, awe, honor, adoration, and worship. It could even be translated as love for God. It recognizes the power, majesty, and holiness of God Almighty. It leads to a healthy respect of God, and the antidote to all other fears and phobias we experience in life. Fear God, and you need not fear anything else or anyone else. Let me repeat that last line. Fear God, and you need not fear anything else or anyone else. You see, church, We love God. We love to do what is commanded of us because of our respect, our reverence, our awe, honor, adoration, and worship towards God. That's the fear of the Lord working within us. Our fourth thought today is this: be known as a friend of God. There was a song that I used to sing, some of us sing. We used to sing it a lot back in the day, so to speak, years ago. And the song simply had a line in it that said this: I am a friend of God, and he calls me friend. What a great thing to be known by, being known as a friend of God. Could there be a greater compliment for your life or my life than being known as a friend of God? When I think of our scripture today from John 15, I thought of this quote, and I thought it was applicable for us today. It'll be on the screen. It says this: God whispers because his priority is intimacy, not entertainment. Learn to listen, long to hear his voice, thirst for his presence. I have called you friends. The Lord Jesus, he has called you and I friends. Church, there is so much yelling in our culture that we forget true friends. Don't yell. The Spirit of God certainly doesn't yell to get our attention. The Lord Jesus, he whispers to you and to me. You and I must learn to listen. When we do, we will thirst for his presence. Some of us really need to learn to listen. You know who you are. But we all need to learn to listen. A little less yelling, a little more listening leads us to a thirst for the presence of God. Some don't agree with me, which doesn't really matter. But there is one antidote for the troubles that we face in the days that we live in. There's one thing that solves the troubles that we face in these days. His name is Jesus, and he has died on the cross for you and for me. And guess what? He's called us. He's called you, and he's called me friend. He's called us friend. What a great joy to be called a friend of the Lord Jesus, the Son of God. Our next thought today is simply this: you are chosen. Just as Jesus calls us friends, we recognize that the Lord Jesus, he has chosen you and he's chosen me. Today, someone that's hearing this message needs to hear and know that you are chosen. I know someone is joining us today at one of our campuses. You need to know that you are chosen by God. This is a truth that is true for every single one of us. The Lord led me as I was preparing for today's message to Isaiah chapter 49, verses 1 through 3. It says this: Listen to me, O coastlands, and give attention, you peoples from afar. The Lord called me from the womb, from the body of my mother, he named my name. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he hid me away. And he said to me, you are my servant Israel, in whom I will be glorified, even in your mother's womb. Jesus, the Lord Jesus has chosen you. The Lord Jesus has chosen you. You are chosen by the Lord. I know sometimes I get annoyed, but the Lord reminds me that I am chosen for what he has called me to do. I am chosen for what he has called me to do. To the family he's put me in, to the people that I share my life with, to the friends my children have, to the spirit that he's put within me. God has chosen me. I am chosen. You are chosen. Just like me, you are chosen by the Lord Jesus. Church, we are chosen. God has put us together for such a time as this. Isn't that crazy? He's put us all together for such a time as this. Maybe like me, you're wondering, why did he do that? But we are chosen. So we've come to the end of the first part of these Vision Sunday messages. We'll continue next week, as I've already said to all of us. Well, here's the proof that we're looking for today about bearing fruit. How do you know that we have a growing relationship with Jesus Christ? How do you know that we have a growing relationship with Jesus Christ? Our final thought, growing fruit that sustains. Growing or bearing fruit means that we keep the commands of the Lord, as outlined in verses 8 and 10 in our text. And secondly, we are guided by the Spirit. So growing fruit means that we keep the commands of the Lord and we are guided by the Spirit. You'll always find someone in your life that will make you feel like it's okay to not follow the commands of the Lord as we read them in Scripture. Don't worry about going to church this week. Don't worry about sacrificially giving to the church. Don't worry about serving in the church. Don't worry about keeping up your walk with the Lord. Don't worry about your devotions. Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. You'll also discover that we often are guided in our life in a multitude of ways. Multitudes of things will push us different directions. However, truly being guided by the Spirit takes time. Once again, we must learn to listen and long to hear His voice. One of the most common things I've come across in so many folks over the years is that so many of us are impatient when it comes to the Lord. We commit ourselves to a spiritual discipline for a short period of time, maybe a week or two, 3 weeks. And when we don't get out of that discipline what we think we should, we give up. I want you to remember this today. When we consider our vision statement, leading people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ, and then we actually evaluate ourselves, how do we know that we're growing in our relationship with Jesus Christ? And when you think of this message and when you think about bearing fruit, that's what Jesus tells us to do, is bear fruit. And when you feel like giving up, I want you to think of this. Learn to listen, not to me, to the voice of the Lord. Learn to listen and long to hear His voice. If your spiritual growth is only coming through the words I say, you're going to be let down. If your spiritual growth is only coming through the words of someone you trust and is experienced in the things of God, you're going to be let down. Long to listen. Learn to listen to the voice of the Lord. Long to hear His voice. Learn to listen and long to hear His voice. That's what I do. Lord, teach me to listen today. I hope I've listened correctly, Lord. And I long to hear Your voice speak over me. Lord, I long to hear Your voice speak over everyone who's gathered with us today. So today, church, what are you thirsting for? What are you thirsting for? Well, here we are, back to life. I have a hard time expressing some of my thoughts as we begin this year with our theme, Back to Life. I'm sure it has different implications for each and every one of us. I was encouraged by the excitement last week as I shared what I feel the Lord is speaking to our Northern Life Church family this year of 2022. There was an excitement online. There was an excitement in Espanola. I'm sure there was an excitement in Little Current. I hope that when you consider Back to Life as a statement over your life, over our church for this year, I hope that when you consider first that you seek the presence of the Lord. When you think of Back to Life, I hope that you would first consider seeking the presence of the Lord. We all need to set aside time to see the Spirit speak strongly into us. Even this week, the Lord's reminded me of some things I need to let go of. Some things that are absorbing time and energy in my life that I need to release. They don't mean anything. They're just silly little things. We all need to set aside time to see the Spirit speak strongly into us. Get rid of the noise in your life and learn to listen and long to hear his voice. Don't long to hear any other voice. Long to hear the voice of the Lord Jesus, the Spirit of God speaking within you. Next week, we'll be taking a look at our mission statement and then also our core values, hopefully. When you think of the mission statement at our church, when you hear the word mission at our church, I want you to think of this: reach, build, and raise. Reach, build, and raise. And then we have our core values. When you hear the phrase core values as it's connected to our church, I want you to think of this. First off, the Word of God, which is the Bible, the Scriptures. And then missions. And then spiritual family, generosity, development. These are some of the things we're going to discuss in the coming days and weeks. Let's pray together. Then I have a short scripture reading. I just want to kind of prophetically pray over our Northern Life Church family today. But let's pray first. So God, we just thank you for today. Lord, I thank you for Vision Sunday. I thank you that we can come together. Lord, I thank you for the wonderful attendance we've had at Northern Life Church recently. God, I pray that your Spirit, as we are seeing a hunger for God, I pray that people would hear your voice, maybe for the first time. God, if someone's joining us today for the very first time, I pray that you've spoken to them, you've released your power and your witness and your glory in their lives. God, we pray for protection and favor upon them, for safety and peace and comfort in these days. God, we lift our eyes to you. And God, we draw our strength from you. Those of us that are feeling tired and weak, we look to you for strength in these days. So God, would you be with our Northern Life Church family? No matter if we're gathering online today in our Little Kern campus or right here where I'm standing in our Espanola campus. God, I pray that you be with us today. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. I have a scripture. It's from the book of Matthew. It's one of my favorites. I want to just prophetically declare it over our church today. God is speaking a new word into us. It says this: you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Well, church, it's been great gathering together today. Thank you so much for spending your Sunday morning with us. I'm so honored that you've chosen to be right here with us today. We love you. If we can serve you in any capacity, please reach out to us at Northern Life Church. We'd love to hear from you, and we look forward to what God has in store. It's been cold lately. Stay warm, stay safe, and we will see you soon. God bless everyone.
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Yes, I do. Still the blood and washed in water.